Welcome to Politics Done Right on KPFT. I am your host, Egberto Williams. This is the progressive program that will take the mystery out of politics. This is the program that will encourage you to make sure government becomes we the people. Whether you are liberal, conservative, or otherwise, you get to air your point of view. Give me a call at 713-526-5738. That is 713-526-KPFT. Remember, you can also send me a tweet to EGBERTOWILLIES. That is at Egberto Williams. Let us engage. It is politics done right.
1, 2, 3, 4. Well, folks, welcome to one more edition of Politics Done Right. I'm Egberto Willis, your host. Thank you so kindly for being a part of the program today. We are going to have a great show. I'm here with Shannon McCurchy, the grand producer. How are you doing, my dear friend?
Hey, Egberto. It's great to be here, as always, with you on Thursday.
Yes, ma'am. And we have a show. Why don't you tell our audience about our show?
Well, I mean, this week has been a busy, busy week. And it feels a little satisfying, finally, in my opinion, my humble opinion.
Yes, I think your opinion is right.
But there is a lot more going on out there. It's exhausting keeping up with all of this.
Yes, it is exhausting, but you know what? It has to be done.
So we want to make sure we're not too distracted with this tiny taste of satisfaction.
And that is, you know what? That's our job, though, Shannon. That's why we do what we do, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
We do what we do because we want to make sure that our brothers and sisters out there, that they stay informed and they keep their eyes
on the ball,
right?
Mm-hmm.
But you know, let's go ahead and get started. We're gonna have a great show, folks. Listen, this is the most dangerous time for progressives. Why is it the most dangerous times for progressives? Because we are smelling blood. Remember, Donald Trump was never a Republican. They hate him. But eventually, they realize he could strategically activate their base and triangulate to attract a portion of the Obama voter, not win the popular vote, but win what? The electoral vote, which is what they're do what he did. No other Republican primary candidate could do that. Mike Pence, had he run, could not. But Mike Pence is a type of Republican the base loves, and they may yet get him. Now, the ironic part about this entire situation is that the intellectual, deficient, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, racist Donald Trump with a populist facade could likely get the health care system every right-wing Republican has been salivating for, which is anathema to what he campaigned for. It's anathema to his promises. We know that. You know that. They know that. But guess what? As his poll numbers begin to fall, he becomes more discardable. But what we must be cognizant of is that we cannot allow, again, we cannot allow the grand pilfer. We cannot allow the grand pilfer that is about to occur. We have to be ready. And thenceforth, the danger. Hi, Danny Cardwell. How are you doing, my friend? According to Danny on Facebook Live, keep pushing. I thank God for our commitment to justice. Absolutely, folks. So as his poll numbers begin to fall, he becomes more discardable. But what we must be cognizant of is that we cannot allow the grand pilfer to occur. We will discuss all this in the blog of the week, or we'll discuss some of this in the blog of the week as it relates to Trumpcare. But we'll discuss a whole lot more. Before I get into the program, I want to remind you all that KPFT is a bastion of intelligent voices and programs. As a political activist myself, I have a few favorites, and they start this way. The Monitor
with Mark Babawi. He does such a great show.
It's an excellent show.
So it's on every Monday at 7 p.m. right after Blues and Hi-Fi.
Great show. We have Think Wing Radio with
Mike Honig on Mondays at 9 p.m.
Then, of course, your other show, Partisan Gridlock with
none other than Jeff Berg, every Friday at 3 p.m.
And we have Open Journal
with Marlo Blue, Dwayne Bradley, and for the time being, Hedy Van Bagel. That is every Monday. Well, actually, she's out now, but
isn't she still doing the show? Or
I if she has, then that's just been okay. You know, a few parting favors.
Right.
But no, that's every month. Well, every morning, weekdays at 8 a.m. My goodness.
And then we have Jazz Latino Afro-Cuban Latin Jazz at its best, hosted by
Juan Flores, every Monday at 10 p.m.
El Señor Don Flores. And then we have The Human Condition at 3 p.m., followed by The Free Minstrel Show with Don and Dwayne at 4 p.m. on Fridays on the KPFT HD3 site. Folks, check out our full schedule at kpft.org, where you can find programming from music to politics to medicine to the eclectic. KPFT is listener-supported public community radio station, so please remember that if you like what you hear, visit kpft.org and ensure we remain a strong, viable community radio station that provides news programming and information not influenced by the corporatocracy. Before I give my last paragraph, before I start the blog of the week, I want to urge my brothers and sisters out there. This is the only progressive leaning station that we have in Southeast Texas in this area. We do need your support. We need your support today. We will need your support tomorrow. We will need your support going forward. You can make this place be, well, this place is already a gem, but you can help us do our job. You can help us get the message out so that once again, we can have the kind of, to my listeners, the social justice that we need in this country, the economic justice that we need in this country, the gender justice that we need in this country, the sex justice that we need, or sexual orientation justice, and the lack of sexism. How do you best say that? I want to make sure that gender equality.
Yes, there we go. Gender equality. In all of its forms.
I love that what you said, in all of its forms. That is what we stand for. That is what America is supposed to stand for. That is what America is supposed to become. We know our origins, but we know that we can change. Anyhow, the KPFT, this is KPFT 90.1 FM in Houston, Texas. We want to hear your voice. We want to hear your thoughts. We want to hear everything that you have to say. Lorenzo Holder, Viva Panama! Friend from Panama listening on Facebook Live. And we have Billy Allison Irwin listening to KPFT over KPFT over Facebook Live. Share these videos, share these shows in real time so that we can bring all these folks into the fold. Remember, that is how we are going to become the mass media. That is how we're going to get the message out. We don't need the corporatocracy to get our message out. We can do it if we band together and do what we're supposed to do. But you know what time it is?
It's time for the weekly blog post.
Okay. And before I jump into the blog post, I want to remind you that this is a call-in show, so please remember to call 713-526-5738. Get in the front of the queue so that we can be ready to take those calls right after the blog of the week. Again, that is 713-526-5738. Whatever part of the world you're in, give us a call. Anyhow, the name of the blog post is "Don't Get Fooled by the Snake Oil Marketing of Trumpcare, the Obamacare replacement." Why am I yet again talking about Obamacare? This is just a template, because it's not just Obamacare. It's also the tax cuts. It's also the cuts in regulations. It's also the environment. While we hyperventilate, and we must, but while we continue to talk about Russia, impeachment, we may yet get the guy. My question is always, what's after? We'll talk about that in a little bit. Anyway, here it goes. The one thing the plutocracy and their political establishment cohort are good at doing is fooling people into voting against their interests. And they could win Trumpcare with that as well. What do I mean? I purposely did not put Republican establishment in my sentence because our corrupt healthcare system is a function of corrupt politicians from both parties, just with different gradations of evil. I have said this a million times, and it was not Republicans who created the current dysfunctions in Obamacare. It was a collusion of certain corporatist Democrats using corporatist Republicans as an excuse for a flawed bill dependent on private insurance and that allowed drug companies to continue the pilfer of drugs taxpayers were instrumental in developing. Again, taxpayers developed these drugs with their research, with the research dollars they provided, and when it was time to capitalize on those drugs, hey, forget about the taxpayer. We are going to make the money for just the few, the people who own these drug companies, who then put out patents that keep these prices high. Democrats held a filibuster-proof Senate long enough to defeat Republican intransigence, but insurance companies and other factions in the medical industry owned those establishment Democrats as well. Progressives will win when we earn the trust of the American people. Being better than is not sufficient. I want to repeat that. Just being better than is not sufficient because right-wing marketing has quickly closed that gap. That is why Republicans win. Progressives must show the conviction of their values in all issues, including healthcare. They must use, or they must not hesitate on our values at all. No hesitation. Values, values, values. To be clear, I want Obamacare fixed until we elect politicians with spines to ignore the lobbyists that transfer our system to a single-payer Medicare for all system. It is the only system proven to work where all citizens get covered at an affordable cost. Let's get a public option to compete against the insurance companies pilfering the middle class, purchasing these policies while giving corporate accounts attractive rates. What I'm saying in the interim, yes, let's get a public option, but ultimately a Medicare for all system. The one thing we must not do is fall into the trap that somehow Trumpcare, a bill that guts Medicaid and provides billions of dollars in tax cuts for the wealthy out of taxes that pay for the Affordable Care Act, can somehow be a better alternative. In other words, don't buy into the crap that somehow we're going to take out over $1 trillion out of healthcare and somehow magically things are going to get better for everybody else. All those people that are without insurance, they're suddenly going to be able to afford insurance. If they're going to be able to afford insurance, it means that what they've bought is junk. Because insurance in the private sector costs a hell of a lot of money. Look, a Kaiser article titled "Pre-Existing Conditions and Continuous Coverage, Key Elements of GOP Bill" lays out the pitfalls that the Trumpcare snake oil salespersons are talking about. The following story, the article points out, is probative. And listen to this guy's story. Before he was diagnosed with head and neck cancers in 2015, Anthony Kinsey often went without health insurance. He is a contract lawyer working for staffing agency on short-term projects in Washington, D.C. area. And sometimes the 90-day wait period for coverage through a staffing agency provided longer than the duration of his project, if coverage was offered at all. When Kinsey, now 57, learned he had cancer, he was able to sign up for a plan with a $629 monthly premium because the agency he was working for offered group coverage that became effective almost immediately. The plan covered the $62,000 surgery to cut out the diseased bone and tissues on his left side of his face, as well as chemotherapy and facilitation. His share of the treatment for that $62,000 bill, $1,800. If the American Health Care Act, which the House recently passed, becomes the law, people like Kinsey, who have health problems, might not fare so well trying to buy insurance after a lapse. The Republican bill would still require insurers to offer coverage to everyone, including people who have pre-existing medical conditions, such as diabetes, asthma, or even cancer. But it would allow states to opt out of the federal health law's prohibition against charging sick people more than healthy ones in those states. if people have a break in coverage of more than 63 days, if you're sick and can't work, you could easily lose those 63 days. Insurers could charge them any price for coverage for approximately a year, efficiently putting coverage out of reach for many sick people. Analysts say after a year, they would be charged a regular rate again, but it gets much worse. Some health policy analysts suggest that it is not only people who have a gap in coverage who could be affected if a state seeks the health law waiver. There could be consequences for anyone with a pre-existing condition, even if those who have maintained continuous coverage are hit. And not only that, remember this, folks, if you're working for an employer, that employer now, even though you have this great insurance from a great employer, that employer now has the option to give you the same crappy insurance that we get on the individual markets. Think about this, people. For all of you that think it only affects the individual, the person who works for themselves, the person who doesn't have regular insurance, even employer-based insurance will be hit by this change in the AHCA. Even employer-based insurance. So if you think, because I have employer-based insurance, I'm okay, forget it. It's not the case. If you have a pre-existing condition, you're going to be put into the block of business with a sicker risk pool, said Sabrina, a researcher at Georgetown University, who's putting out for healthcare reform. Now look, the fallacies about high-risk pools, there are a lot of fallacies about high-risk pools. Here is this. State high-risk pools, which are available in 35 states before the HCA passed, have been widely criticized. However, as inadequate for people with expensive healthcare needs. Premiums were often extremely high, and there were frequently lifetime or annual limits on coverage, something that went away with Obamacare. Some plans excluded coverage for as long as a year for the very condition people needed the plan for. Look, folks, irrespective of high-risk pools, where there's ample evidence they do not work, the callousness and disregard for humanity for those who allow their coverage to lapse, many times out of necessity, is expressed by the conservative American Enterprise Institute resident fellow Thomas Miller. Here's what he said. High-risk pools offer a reasonable solution for the 2 million to 4 million people in the individual market he estimates have pre-existing conditions, which he's lying, it's more than that, but would otherwise be medically uninsurable or offered such high cost coverage that they couldn't afford. But listen to the callousness of this guy. Besides, he argued, the high rates would last for only a year. Once you've been paid up, you gradually get back to regular market rates. It's not like being sentenced to the gulag. Are you kidding me? If the person can't make the payments for a month, how the hell are they going to make it for a year? Where is your empathy? Where is the belief that your folks believe in life, the sanctity of life? When people, if you look at the little graphic I have for the show today, it is one of Donald Trump's healthcare cards. And you know what it says? If you get sick, die quickly. If you get sick.
Where did it say that?
That is a made up Trump card. You know, it's come on, it's not real.
I know. What?
It's a made up Trump card. If you get sick, quickly die. Because that's what happens in a year. They're telling you, okay, if you want to get into the high risk pool for this particular condition that you've had before, just wait a year and then we'll cover it. And in a year, you're dead.
True. I mean, yeah. What are you going to do?
This is a sickness that's going. This is the type of evil we're talking about, people. And this is what you're not hearing on mainstream TV. These are the severity of what these people are talking about. Folks, the only solution ultimately is Medicare for all, a single payer system. Now, in the interim, we have a stopgap. It's called Obamacare. We have to make sure they do not kill it. We have to make sure they keep it alive until we elect the right people into office that will ensure America moves into the humane planet of given people good health care. Folks, the telephone number is 713-526-5738. Again, that number is 713-526-5738. Let me hear from you. Call now. Please don't wait till the end of the show when we start to have to kind of speed things up because a whole rash of calls come in. The blog of the week is over. Let's go to line number one. Come on in, Tag.
Hi, Egberto. How you doing?
I'm doing fine. Talk to me, my friend.
You know, I think we can all be happy, including the Republicans, that Trump has gotten something special now, right? The special counsel.
The special counsel, he sure has gotten something special, didn't he?
Yeah, we're all so happy for him. And, you know, last night on TV, I saw both Paul Ryan and Donald say that they're happy that the special counsel has been appointed so they can get this past them, which I saw coming. I mean, there was a quote from both of the same verbiage, you know,
right.
like they had rehearsed it. But it made me think, you know, being happy of a special counsel is kind of like being happy you're getting a tooth pulled that hurts.
I never quite heard it like that. But let me tell you something. I am, believe it or not, I wrote a blog post just before I came to the studio, right?
Yeah.
And the blog post was titled, I want to give you the right title, because in as much as we agree, I agree with what you said, there's a little bit of caution that I have. The title of the blog post that I wrote right before I came here was, Speaker Paul Ryan is right, and progressives better listen lest working class pilfer continues. And what I mean by that is, while, you know, he's partially right that with the special counsel there now, they can say, oh, we got to wait for the special counsel, no distraction. And if they don't have a lot of distraction, then they're back there working on all the little things that are going to really hurt us. Reducing the, and I have a video attached to it that I want everybody to watch as well, because Paul Ryan started to enumerate all the things that they did that Trump has already signed. And what was interesting is some of the regulations they signed, I never heard about it on TV, but it was written, it was passed by Congress, the House, it was approved by the Senate, passed by the Senate as well, sent to the president's office, and it got signed. 14 regulations got removed. I'm not sure what they are yet, but all of that has been happening under the radar. But we are so consumed with the Russian thing, which we have to be consumed with as well, but all these other things are happening. So we have, that's one of the purposes of the program today. Remind folks to say one important thing. Yes, we're glad there's a special prosecutor. Yes, we're going to keep the heat on Trump. But what comes after number one? Number two, we have to be vigilant as far as the other things that are occurring. What do you say, Tag?
I agree. And let me say this. You know, if you have a bad tooth and you need to get it pulled, why has that happened? And there's basically three reasons.
Mm-hmm.
One, the tooth is rotted, right? The other one is the tooth is broke. And the third one is that there's just not enough room in that space for that tooth, so it's got to come out. And to me, That signifies
right
two of the three branches of our government right now.
Right.
So you know, the government's got problems, and I think those three things are. Now, one thing I wanted to mention real quick is that anybody that's looked into Mueller's history, the special counsel?
Yes, sir.
He was actually, him and Comey, was actually involved with George W. Bush. You probably know this, don't you?
Oh, yeah. You're talking about when they went to that guy's, the attorney general's bedside when he was really sick, and they tried to get him to pass some, not a law, because he can't pass a law, but get him to do something that was fairly illegal.
George W.
Right.
Was going to have unwarranted search warrant.
Search warrant. That's what it was, yes.
Yep. And Comey and Mueller both told Bush that if the White House did not stand behind them, they're
quit.
Both quitting.
Yes,
and,
I remember
and,
that.
And Bush said, okay, we won't do it then. So, you know, I have a lot of faith in Mueller and Comey here. I think, you know, if anything good's happened, it's been this.
Well, let me just tell you one thing before I go to the other caller, Tag.
Yeah.
I have faith in none of them until the results come out. And the reason why, and the reason I'm saying that is that, Comey already, was partially responsible for throwing the election. I don't think that he necessarily wanted to do that. I think he just wanted to maintain his establishment Republican bona fides. But that's just my thought. But look,
yep.
Tag, thank you very much for your call, my friend.
Thanks, Ted Barrow. Have a good week.
You Bye-bye. Too. Now, let's go to line number four. Let's go to William. Come on in, William.
I'm right here.
Talk to me.
Hey, great show as usual. I haven't had a chance to talk to you in a while.
All right, talk to me, sir.
Okay, you know about that big media conglomerate that's getting bigger than Fox, that's going to be dominating like two-thirds of the country where basically Pacifica doesn't even exist other than a college station?
Let me think if I can think that new media that is growing past Fox News. Is it MSNBC?
No. This is a whole new organization that's run by one of these extreme right-wing...
Give me the name.
I can't remember the name, but it's been on Pacifica. It's been on the Tom Hartman show. I can't remember the name, but somebody else will bring it up before this is over.
Okay, whoever is listening.
Another thing I want to go to.
Go ahead, sir.
Have you been watching The View at all?
I haven't watched The View in a long time, but I kind of like getting the snippets of it here and there. Tell me what you want.
Oh, my God. You know, it's on the same time the repeat of Charlie Rose's, right?
But right.
Oh, man. It's like watching five ladies take Donald Trump and hang him from a tree and skin him.
Well, the one thing I do know that occurred on The View a few days ago is that the conservative person finally came out and gave Trump a piece of her mind. So... I guess things are changing.
Well, she gets stupid, and then all of a sudden somebody comes on and starts, I forget who it was, and started talking about what it was like to be, you know, somebody that wasn't like she is, and, you know, what he had to go through. And it's a famous person that was on there, and she just started gulping.
Right. Well,
yeah,
I mean...
She is what she is, but she's basically already turned on, But, you know, the part that amazes me about The View is that they're sitting there going, how in the world did this happen? When I can tell everybody how in the world this happened.
Well,
and, you know, it's not, you know, hard to figure. Basically, you know, there's thousands of multi-generation crime families in this country, and most of them... a Republican.
Well,
extended families have matriculated into all the phases of the government.
Let me just say one thing, William, because and it's not. I am no fan of Republicans or establishment. Notice I said establishment Democrats or whatever, because I surely believe in the principles of the...
That's why nobody could do anything. They've all been so corrupted they can't say a word.
Right, and so what I'm saying is this: I think it is high time for us to start. What we need to start working on is putting out, just say that what we're going to start running are progressives. In other words, I want those you're not going to get Republicans running as progressives. You're going to get Democrats running as progressives.
I'm not trying to do any of that. I'm
right.
just trying, you know, I love what our congressman, he just jumped right out there and said it. You know, about impeaching Bush, I mean, Trump.
Right.
Both of them, for that matter. But, yeah, I mean, I know him. He knows me.
Right.
I've met him. I haven't met you.
All right, William. Well, let me tell you, great to hear your voice after not hearing it for a while, and I got to get to another caller, so...
I'm going on vacation.
Great. Well, you have...
You really need to interview me so we can get this other stuff out of the way.
I'm
not after anybody.
I know, my friend. Look, we talk to you later, William. You have a great day. Let's go to Johnny on line number two. Come on in, Johnny. Talk to me.
Two items. One, this thing about memos.
Yes.
Memos work in the case of this Trump thing. If you post them into a repository or a third party that has control over it, similar to when a small business person files their quarterly income statements to the IRS.
Right.
Because if you wait until the end of the year, you can make up things more easily, and the IRS has a harder time trying to triangulate where you're at. So similarly, a memo or some kind of after-the-fact document that you create within a reasonable amount of time, that has to be filed somewhere. You just can't save it. Otherwise, it's meaningless.
Right.
And also, I forget the name of the movie, but there's this final scene where the prison warden, he puts a revolver to his head and he fires before facing the humiliation of the perk walk and criminal prosecution for corruption and profiteering off the prison labor.
Uh-huh.
I can't remember the name of the movie because, after all, I'm suffering from something maybe Donald Trump did. But I'm thinking if he is suffering from early dementia, which he could be, then there's another risk of suicide. especially if he's facing arrest or even something as simple as a public ringing a fire through the Senate and Congress, you know, for what's it called when you try them but you don't take them out of office?
Impeach.
Impeachment, right. So something as simple as impeachment might be enough to push him over the edge, because after all, Melania does not like him. And when you've got no family support, watch out. You take some people with you.
That is so true, my friend. Is that your last point, my dear friend?
That's it.
Well, look, thank you for calling as usual. You have a
suicide march on his cell.
There you go, my brother. Thank you for
calling. He's referring to Shawshank Redemption.
You meant Shawshank Redemption.
He's gone.
Okay, great. All right, let's go to line number 3. Come on in. Oh, do I need to break first? Okay, let me get to a break, then I get to you, John.
It is currently 3:30, and now for a brief look at our roadways. Slow going in a few areas around town, including on the West Loop between Forness and Post Oak in both directions, and on the North Freeway outbound from Cavalcade out to West. And there's a few minor accidents around town, including along the West Loop southbound right near Westheimer. There's also an accident at Washington on Washington Avenue near Kansas, and at the intersection of South Shepherd and Fairview. Expect delay. And now for a brief look at weather. It's currently 89 degrees, windy, and partly cloudy skies. Mostly cloudy tonight with a low around 75. And expect warm, humid, and muggy Friday with a slight chance of precipitation. Otherwise, partly cloudy tomorrow with a high near 89 degrees. That's look your Houston area weather and traffic. I'm Shannon McCurchy, and you're listening to KPFT Houston 90.1. Back to you, Egberto.
Muchísimas gracias, hermana. Anyway, folks, we have open lines. The telephone number is 713-526-5738. Again, that number is 713-526-5738. Let's go to line number 3. John, come on in, John.
Good afternoon, Egberto. How you doing?
Hey, my friend. Talk to me.
Okay. The thing that the guy was talking about with the corporate takeover, that those are individual stations, and it's the Sinclair Group is what he's talking about.
Oh, okay.
And they're also they're putting a lot of right wing propaganda. I mean, very pro Trump stuff, and all the local news stations, and they're like demanding that they read this stuff. I mean, it's really indoctrination. So it's really bad.
I think I did come across that. I didn't really recognize Sinclair, because Sinclair been around for a while.
Right. I mean, that's true. I believe that this is also put through Trump administration. They weren't. Obama wasn't going to do it, but I mean, he wants to have corporations get bigger and bigger, and so that's something he put in. That's my understanding.
Got it.
As far as you were talking about these things that passed the House and the Senate and Trump signing them.
Yes.
I just looked this stuff up, and I don't see anything like that.
I made mention of that, John, because this is what Paul Rand just said this morning in the interview. And when he said all of this, I'm like, well, it's interesting that we're having these debates in the Senate, the debate in the House, the bill signed, according to Paul Ryan. And, you know, we haven't heard anything about it. And he talks about 14 different regulations getting cut. And we know what regulations they want to cut. So, again, to the audience at large, this what I was regurgitating is Paul Ryan's news conference in which he said those bills were passed. Continue, my friend.
Well, I mean, I'm just saying on the White House website,
right?
You know, there's nothing to do with health care that he had passed. There's all kinds of other bills that he had passed.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. If I said I didn't mean health care, I meant regulations, and some other things. It wasn't about health care.
Okay. All right. Okay. So anyway, I want to talk about the Senate and how what they're doing on the AHCA, the bill that
yes.
The House passed. Now it's been stalled in the Senate, and so I mean I still advise everybody to call Cornyn, to call Cruz, and even though I don't think they're not going to listen very much, but do your civic duty, call them, tell them that you don't want to have this pass. But, you know, the moderates, the so-called moderates, you know, they're holding their ground. And I'm not saying this is going to continue forever, but I'm just saying, you know, at this point, you know, 9 days after the House, you know, went on recess, you know, 9 business days,
mm-hmm.
you know, they're not close to any kind of solution at all. And so, you know, I'm hoping that's going to continue. I'm hoping, you know, the moderates don't cave like they did in the House. But, you know, we'll have to see. But, I mean, just as it is right now, they're holding, you know, strong with the fact that, you know, they don't want to have they want to keep the individual mandate in place. They want the Medicaid expansion in place, because there are 20 different Republicans that come from states that have the Medicaid expansion.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, we'll just have to see. I mean, I'm not as pessimistic as some people are about this, you know, not going through the Senate. I don't think it's going to go through the Senate. I mean, again, you know, activists make calls and you know, continue that, because, you know, I think one of the reasons why it did pass a couple of weeks ago, because the press was saying this isn't going to pass, and then all of a sudden it did pass.
I am concerned, John, that it actually is going to pass. Nowhere necessarily close to the manner in which they're doing the AHCA from the House. My other concern is that the reason I think they have to pass it is they have to find some monies that can actually give tax cuts through reconciliation. Otherwise, they need 60 votes. So I think that it is instrumental for them to pass some sort of a gutting of Obamacare in order to find that money for their tax cuts. So, I mean, my thing is, like, it is existential for all of their tax cuts. It is existential for that. And then they have to find a way to cloak it into Obamacare repeal or something like that. That's just my thought.
Yeah, no, I mean, I hear what you're saying, but I'm just saying, you know, I mean, I've been following,
mm-hmm.
you know, very closely what's been going on, you know, since the election,
mm-hmm.
and since all the senators have been, you know, there's at least 10 senators that have been extremely skeptical of the whole idea of what was passed before, you know, let's say in 2015 and put on Obama's desk, which is the bill that was passed by the House is actually worse.
Right.
And so they're very concerned about this. And so let's hope that they don't cave and nothing comes out of the Senate. Another thing, you know, about the sabotage, which I'm actually much more concerned about,
right?
Because I mean, this is happening
now,
and this is happening right now,
mm-hmm.
and you know, I mean, and we're seeing these. I mean, a lot of people are getting increases, you know, left and right. We're seeing averages on the lower, like the silver plans,
mm-hmm.
between 10% and 20%. On the expensive plans, the gold plans, we were seeing, you know, like that. I think the average was a 54% increase in Virginia, 54% in Maryland. And so, you know, this is just going to be, you know, who's going to win the propaganda war? Trump's going to say it's Obama's fault.
But let me ask you to hold a second there, John, because that is what 2 weeks ago when I spoke about this, that was my concern when I talk about, you remember the thing was high, was it 2 weeks ago? I think I spoke about hyperventilation of the, yeah.
That was last week.
Oh, that was last week. Okay. I didn't even realize that was last week. There's so much that happened since.
The news cycle moves so quickly.
Oh, I know. But yeah, and that was my big concern, John. That was my big concern, Shannon. And the reason why is because there's this underlying Obamacare destruction that's occurring, and on not funding the part of the insurance companies to prevent those types of rate hikes from occurring. So, I mean, look, we have a lot of work to do, and I think we have to change the narrative to also be that right now they're purposefully sabotaging, and maybe we need to use a different type of word that is more mainstream, that they're destroying the healthcare system. But I got to go to another call, my friend. Anything else you want to say real quickly, sir?
No, good show. I appreciate what you do, and you having a show on Saturday?
I should be having a show on Saturday, my friend. We'll be there. Okay, my brother?
All right, sounds
good. Thank you. Have a good one
now. All right.
All right, let's go to linea numero uno with Mike. Come on in, Mike.
Hey, how you doing, Alberto?
I'm doing fine. Talk to me, sir.
Okay, let me ask you, and I don't think it's true, but what if this is all just totally a smokescreen for Donald Trump to get everything he wants passed in the House and the Senate?
Let me see if I understand what you're saying. In other words, you're thinking that Russia is a smokescreen, and the reason it's a smokescreen is later on it's going to come out that it was all a smokescreen, and liberals and progressives and all these guys are going to look crazy, and that's going to then give them the option to just get everything through. I think that's what you mean, right?
Yeah, I'm hoping it's real.
Let me tell you something, okay? About this guy. I think out of this thing, and I think there's a distinct possibility that Manafort and what's his name? Flynn will get sort of a black eye out of all this stuff.
Right.
And that Donald Trump walks. In other words, it just turns out that there's nothing there that they can tie Trump to. And that wouldn't surprise me because Trump is so intellectually deficient that I do not believe he himself really knows what's going on.
Yeah. Okay. You know, he didn't even want the job. He just happened to.
Right. So I think he is like somebody that everybody plays with. And in doing so, yes, I think he could walk. And if you read some of my blogs that I did one on Daily Coast that generated like three other blogs from people agreeing, disagreeing, agnostic, including one blog post that said, guess what? Rahm Emanuel actually agrees with you. That was the title of one of the blogs at Daily Coast. If you take a look at Rahm Emanuel agrees with you, because I take sort of an anti-establishment tack, and you know Rahm Emanuel is completely establishment.
Right.
And to say that he pretty much said the same thing as well. He didn't say something that much different than what you are saying right now, Mike.
Yeah, I'm just afraid that, you know, Trump is going to get away with this. He's going to let a lot of his guys hang.
Right.
But, you know, he doesn't listen to none of his staff. He's a renegade.
Uh-huh. Right. So, I mean, as it turns out, then let me tell you, we have to be cognizant of that. And that's why I keep telling people we need to keep the narrative. When John just spoke about the sabotage of Obamacare in the last call, that is what we should be talking about a whole lot. Because you know what? Come in the next couple of months, the rate's going to be mailed out to all the people. And people are going to see what their rates are going to be in November. And they're going to be screaming. The ones that are going to be screaming are not necessarily going to be the vast majority, because the vast majority are subsidized by 80, 90%. In other words,
right,
a lot of these people are going to get a whole lot of subsidizing. And you know, I mean, so it increases 50% from $70 becomes $100. It increases 50% from $40, you're now paying $60. So you don't really feel the brunt or the big pain. But before my wife started to, she got a job, it was me, because I'm a private business owner, I paid the entire Obamacare bill. And I'm talking $1,200, $1,300 a month with a $6,000 deductible, if not more.
Wow.
Okay. Now, with her taking the insurance with her job, it turns out, guess what? The deductible is ridiculous. I am like in heaven. If I had been saving all the, if we were working for somebody over the last 26 years that I've been paying these crazy rates, we calculated that would have been over $200-something thousand put away.
And where does all this money go to? Right in their pocket.
Right into their pocket. So our family over the years, over the 26 years of our ties, has been over $200,000 in healthcare costs that mostly never got used.
Right.
Think about that.
Ridiculous.
Think about that. So that's the kind of stuff that we're talking about. So, Mike, I agree with you. And what I think you're supposed to be doing, myself and others, is pushing this message. Hey, yeah, let's keep the pressure on Donald Trump. But remember, even if Donald Trump gets impeached, what happens? We get Pence. I think Pence is worse. But here's the kicker. I wrote a little blog yesterday that was kind of interesting. Now, folks, to tell it, we have open line 713-526-5738. Again, that number is 713-526-5738. We still have a few open lines available. Let me tell you what I wrote. I wrote, hey, there's a magical way that you may actually see President Pelosi in 2019. And here it goes. The last word, Joanne Reed said that Trump, not only Trump has a whole lot to worry about, but also Mike Pence. And not only does Mike Pence have a lot to worry about, but maybe Paul Ryan. I mean, if you listen to the video, the audio that Paul Ryan did, where he said he made it seem like he knew that two people were getting, you know, maybe getting some money from the Russians. So he may be a bit conflicted. So here's the scenario. Both Pence and Trump gets impeached under the law in 2018 or in 2019 when the House turns over to the Democrats, and the third in line for the presidency
is Ryan.
But guess what? We have turned over the House in 2018 to the Democrats. So guess who becomes, Pelosi becomes the person, and she then becomes the president. There's actually, it's amazing. And then I put in the end of the blog, is that possible? Yes. Is it probable? No, but I mean, it's not very probable, or it's probable, you know. So I mean, we got to be careful there. But those are things that could happen. But anyway, wouldn't that be great after they've stolen a Supreme Court seat? If we could take back the presidency in that manner, wouldn't that be kind of cool?
Yeah, and as Donald Trump says, I'll see you in the Supreme Court.
Yes. Anyhow, my friend, I got to go to a break now. So look, thank you so kindly for calling, and you have a good one, Mike.
All right,
Brad,
you too,
and David, you guys are coming up next.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Egberto, and good afternoon. Once again, it is currently 89 degrees, expected to be windy this evening, and it's currently partly cloudy skies. It should be mostly cloudy tonight with a low around 75, and another warm, muggy day in store tomorrow. A slight chance of rain, about 20%, and otherwise, it'll be partly cloudy with a high near 89. And let's take a brief look at our roadways. Heavy truck accident cleared from the North Freeway outbound at Cross Timbers. You're tapping on the brakes from Cavalcade out to West, and slow going in a few areas around town, including on the Northwest Freeway outbound from West 34th out to Highway 6, and on 288 between the West Loop and Orem, mostly outbound traffic. And it's starting to back up on the Katy Freeway outbound between the West Loop and bound Beltway 8 area. And a little slow going on the Gulf Freeway outbound from downtown out to the South Loop. That's look your Houston area weather and traffic. I'm Shannon McCurty, and you're listening to KPFT Houston 90.1 Politics Done Right with Egberto Willis.
Muchísimas gracias, Shannon. Let's go to línea número dos con Brad. Come on in, Brad. How you doing, my friend?
Hey, Egberto, and about Nancy Pelosi becoming president, you have a better chance of getting struck by lightning and peck by a great white shark at the same time. So quit even making it's fun, but it's make-believe, okay?
It was intended to be fun. You know, it was intended to be fun. Talk to me, my friend.
Here's the thing. Yeah, people support Obamacare. People support Trumpcare. People support single-payer health, you know, single-payer. All of you people who support these things failed third-grade math, okay?
Mm-hmm. Let me hear it.
Earlier today, mm-hmm. this show, $62,000.
Yes.
Minus $1,800.
$1,800.
Is a little over $60,000.
Yes.
Okay. Where's the money come from?
Mm-hmm.
Now, it comes from other people, but the problem is, it's like Social Security. The reason why Social Security is, you know, going to be having problems is because there's not enough young people and too many old people.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with health care, the way it is that there's not enough healthy people and too many sick people.
Mm-hmm.
Go to Walmart and just look at all those fat asses in there,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
The ones that, you know, they have the handicapped parking up front. I mean, by law, I think if you're fat, you should park at the far end of the parking lot, okay?
Okay.
And the money, where's all the money going to? If you say if it's going to health insurance companies,
mm-hmm.
look, how much do health insurance companies make? They make about a 3 to 4% profit,
mm-hmm.
okay? The money's going to nurses who make good money, pharmacists who make very good money, and doctors who make very, very good money, and I don't think they want to take a pay cut.
All right, let me stop you there because I get the gist of your discussion. First of all, let me first talk about I don't think it's the right thing to talk about fat people. And let me, in the way that you're saying, I understand your concept, but I think what happens in the society that we have today, we have encouraged for all the folks that are overweight, including myself and all the others. Okay. I honestly think that there is something to our society that created that eventuality. For those people who are naturally slim, power to you, and great that you're able to do so. So I don't want to be too judgmental there. Secondly, when it comes to basic math, I have done the basic math, and though what you've said is partially true as far as where the money comes from, you were looking at two sides of the equation. You were looking at hospitals, you're looking at insurance companies. I want to isolate insurance companies first of all. Then I want to isolate drug companies, and then we can really talk. But let me isolate the insurance companies for a while. The insurance companies are, unlike what you said, very, very profitable. In other words, you're talking about 3%. I don't have the exact number of the profit margin. I'll take your number at face value, but 3% of several trillion dollars for a small amount of corporations is huge. It is still the skimming of monies for not providing service. So there's a hell of a lot of money there. But here's what I do know. Obamacare allows 20%, before it used to be 33% or more, of your premiums that went into the pockets of the whole in insurance industry. In other words, somebody sells you an insurance policy for, let's say, it costs $5,000 a year. And that person for the first year who's selling that healthcare policy may pocket that entire $5,000 a year. That is how lucrative those people who were lucky enough, who were blessed to be inside of that cocoon, the insurance cocoon, we're living. The executives that make $22 million, all the advertising that go in. I wrote several articles and I included this in my book, rather. So what I'm saying is, first of all, I'm so far isolating just insurance companies. There's a hell of a lot of money there that is going to pay people that don't deserve to be paid or paying wages that are not deserved. That's only the insurance side. We can have Medicare for all with a 3% overhead as opposed to a private insurance system with a 20% overhead or more when you take the cheating into account. That is
what's Medicare right now?
Medicare is a 3% overhead in Medicare. This is not a question, that's an absolute statement.
It has a deficit.
No, sir. Let me stop you right there. Again, we have to make sure that we don't follow the nomenclature coming from the right wing. There is no deficit in Medicare, and Obamacare saw to it. And how did Obamacare see to it? By taxing. In other words, that same $800 billion in taxes that the Republicans with the AHCA are trying to refund is exactly what Obamacare did to make sure that Medicaid was solvent. Remember, Medicaid is paid out of the 3% tax that's paid on things like capital gains, that's paid on, excuse me, on other types of things. So it was paid for, and that is what we need. Now, what a lot of folks like yourself don't know, my friend, is the following. The amount of capital that we are talking about the wealthy having is orders of magnitude over what we need to solve our healthcare problem if we wanted to, but we choose not to do so. So now I have already given you and the reason why we pay 2 to 3 times more than any other country is that they have realized that we have decided that pilfering the American people, the masses, to help a few is better. Now let's go to the drug side, and I have to
hold on, we got to hold this difficult disease. We got obesity.
This is the reason why we have too much obesity in this country. Sir, you're right.
And even medical doctors have said we could cut everything in half if people would quit eating junk food and exercise.
And they would be wrong. And let me tell you why they would
so
be wrong.
So doctors are wrong. Yes. People who are experts in this are wrong, and you're right. It's not me who's right.
I'm telling you the numbers. I'm not the one who came out with the numbers. There are a lot of very fat people that are very healthy. Let me tell you what we do in the medical industry. And this is where I talk about the industry not being benign, but finding a way. You know how you watch TV and you find drugs that are there now? If you laugh too much, you get a drug. If you have unsteady feet, you get a drug. Same thing, if you're fat, you get a drug. And all these other, that's what they're talking about. The reality, though, is most fat people are healthy.
Okay, how many skinny people do you know that have type 2 diabetes? I have yet
quite
to
a few.
One.
Actually,
I'm sure they could be there, but I've yet to meet one.
Yeah, quite a few. But let me tell you, I don't want. I only have like 3 minutes to take another couple of calls, but I want to continue this conversation. Let's see. Your name is Brad.
It's Brad. Brad. And I don't disagree with you. I think the healthcare system screwed up. Yeah. I think it should be single payer.
Right. But Brad, I know, again, we are having a conversation. That, so what I'm saying is I like the gist of your conversation because I think it can be enlightening to our audience, right? But I want to have it at another time where I can have more time and you can have more time. But right now I got to get to another caller. So we got that together?
Mm-hmm. Have a good weekend and exercise and eat fruits and vegetables.
All right, my brother. You take care, okay?
All right, bye-bye.
All right, man. Let's go to David. David, real quickly, come on in, my friend.
Okay, we have a president.
Yes.
That's going to drain the swamp, and now he's up to that alligator. The problem with that man is that he tweets constantly.
Yes.
So no one can ask him any questions over the tweets.
Right.
Then he's incapable of explaining what he means. He always has his representatives. Well, what he meant was this. What he meant was that he can't say what he means.
Right.
Then on top of everything else, the Electoral College did a big disservice to the whole country.
Let me tell you something, David. You're right, and I beg that you call a little bit earlier the next time because I got to jump to Paul, and then that's going to be my last call. But I do appreciate your call, and you keep calling.
Okay, let me just say one last thing.
Quickly, then. 10 seconds.
Okay. The last thing that I want to say is that if you have nothing to hide, you hide nothing.
I love the phrase. Thank you, my brother. You have a good one, okay?
Okay, bye-bye.
Take care. Okay, Paul, come on in real quickly, my friend.
Okay, hey, real quick, somewhere in the 80s,
mm-hmm.
Democrats and Republicans fixed it where pharmaceutical companies did not have to negotiate prices with with Medicare, Medicaid.
Yes.
And that's part two of the conversation about health care.
Yes.
So the Democrats and the Republicans have sold us out to the pharmaceuticals and the medical and the hospital associations and the insurance companies.
Paul?
But can you... Yes, sir.
No, go ahead, real quickly.
I'd like you to elaborate on that if you have any information, please. Thanks.
Yes.
30 seconds.
Okay, let me tell you real quick. I just got told I got 30 seconds. Here's the deal. You're absolutely right that we were unable to, in Medicare, unable to negotiate with these drug companies. And also in Obamacare, to a certain extent, we left the drug companies alone. And not only that, most of what the drug companies produce are things that the taxpayers paid for to develop. I got to go now, my friend. Thank you so kindly for calling. Call earlier the next time. We are going to be off, we have to get off of the air right now. Folks, this is Egberto Willis, Politics Done Right. Thank you so kindly for being a part of this conversation.
Thank you very much for listening to Politics Done Right. I am your host, Egberto Willis. You can personally reach me by sending an email to Egberto@politicsdoneright.com. Remember, Egberto is spelled EGBERTO. Change starts with you. 90.1 KPFT gives you information not tainted by corporate interest. Please visit kpft.org and contribute. Let's ensure continued access to real information and news remain available to all. Again, thank you very much for listening to Politics Done Right.